Our next speaker, Prince Rama Varma. Prince Rama Varma is a member of the royal court of Travancore, is a direct descendant of Maharaja Shri Swathi Thirunal and Raja Ravi Varma. He is not only trained in Carnatic music under Professor Vichur Hariya Subramanya Iyer, but has also studied the Saraswati Veena under Trivandrum R. Venkatraman. He has had the rare privilege of not only singing in unison with the legendary gurus, but also of having Dr. Balamurli Krishna accompany him on the violin, who he is currently training under. His music is known for the strict adherence to tradition, coupled with his own band of creativity. He specializes in taking classes and giving lecture demonstrations about various aspects of music, having toured countries like USA, UK, France, Germany, Kuwait, Dubai, and Netherlands, to mention a few. Now we welcome Prince Rama Varma to deliver his lecture.
Before offering phrases from compositions of Maharaja, I'd just like to set the background a little bit, which has been ably done by Professor Achyut Shankar. Actually, I would even love to travel all the way to Madras just to listen to him speak. This is such a wealth of information. Because some people were very good at bluffing, and some people were very authentic. So Professor Achyut Shankar is one of the few people I know. If he says anything, you don't have to check again. Everything he says is backed by documentary evidence. As for me, I come from a family which, as you saw, is proud to have had people like Maharaja Swathi Thirunal, Raja Ravi Varma. In every family like that, we have periods of light followed by periods of darkness. And when the light is glowing, we feel it will continue forever. But then unexpectedly comes the period of darkness. When the darkness continues and we feel that there is no hope at all, again something luminous will happen. With Maharaja, what happened is that after he passed away, the Tanjore quartet, except Vadivelu, they went back to Tanjore. And there was very little done to preserve the compositions of Maharaja. After that, very great efforts and good work was done by my great-grandmother, my mother's mother's mother. She was the mother of the last Maharaja of Travancore also. She was called Amma Maharani. And she was virtually the power behind the throne. She was very, very passionate about music in general and about the music of Maharaja Swathi Thirunal in particular. She did amazing work to revive, to propagate and to preserve the compositions of Maharaja by inviting people like Dr. Muthaiah Bhagwathar, Dr. Shyamamala Srinivasa Iyer, Musiri Subramanya Iyer, and so many great vidwans from other parts of the country also. Again, after she passed away, even after she became old, there was some unfortunate time when others were not that interested in music. I owe my life to music, and the single reason why I became attracted to classical music was because of a Kalakshetra product, Sri M.D. Ramanathan. Some of the time I was a kid, some people say, oh, Adilam, Periya Sangeet, only if you really know music can you appreciate M.D. Ramanathan. When I was 3 years old, 5 years old, if somebody asked me, so when you grow up, what do you want to do? What do you want to be? I never said, I want to be a singer. I would always say, I want to be with M.D. Ramanathan. That is all. Even now, that hasn't changed, though I have been with very great creative people like my current guru, Dr. Mangalampally Balamurli Krishna. Somehow there's some obsession with M.D. Ramanathan which only continues to grow year after year. He used to be a regular artist at the Navaratri festival till he passed away in 1984. And even with a child's voice I used to try and imitate singing like him, though I hadn't studied classical music at all at that time. So, to speak about Maharaja, I'll give you two or three other examples. I recently attended a beautiful lecture by Srimati Rukmini Ramani, who's the daughter of Papanasam Sivan. It is a blessing that people like her are still with us and active also. She gave this fascinating lecture about Papanasam Sivan and his compositions. And she said, she cited so many examples of songs, even for films, which he had composed in her presence, which have been attributed to other people. There is one example. Second example, I'm currently studying music for the past 17, 18 years from Dr. Mangalampally Balamurli Krishna. He's not an obscure, unknown person. He's a celebrity and everybody knows Balamurli Krishna. But because of his stature as a performer and people wanting to sing Enduro Mahanubhavalu and Nagamomo and Pibire Ramarasam and Orunal Poduma and songs like that, which I requested again and again, there is this huge wealth of his own compositions which are just amazing. His Padavarnams, his Tilanas, many of them have never seen light of the day even now. And that is the situation in the 21st century. A third example, I see mostly very young faces here. But if there are old people like me here, then you will know what happened to Kalakshetra itself after Rukmini Devi passed away. So in every place, and she was there till the end of the 20th century. So in 20th century and 21st century, great, great people who have contributed so much with their departure, how much wealth of knowledge is gone forever. Then you can imagine 200 years ago what the situation would have been with the Maharaja Swathi Thirunal. So that is just setting the background. I can go on about this, but recently I heard about a Carnatic musician who does Harikatha. And he will talk, and he will talk, and he will talk, and he will talk. He talk. So that somebody attended the show, he was giving a 10-day discourse on Ramayana. And they said, after 8 days, Rama still hadn't gone to the forest because he was going on talking. So I don't want to talk like that. But I'm just giving you the background of this. And there is a Purandara that, again, this is the apt composer to be spoken about in this place. The great Sangeeta Pitamaha Purandara Dasa, he has written an Uga Bhoga Shloka, which starts, Malagi Padidare Kunitu Keluvenu. Kunitu Padidare Nintu. It says, if you lie down and sing, I will sit and listen. If you sit and sing, I will stand up and listen. If you stand up and sing, I will dance and listen. And if you dance and sing, there is nothing more than that, that is heaven itself. So that is what the great Purandara Dasa has said. Among all the composers that I know of, I will never say he is the only one, but among all the composers I know of, Maharaja Swathi Thirunal personifies this concept as the union of dance and music in the same person. In Carnatic music itself, we have Banis, we have Aryakudi Bani, Chemangudi Bani, GNB Bani, Chembai, Madaramani, Balamurli, so many Banis. Many of them are mutually exclusive. In fact, some gurus will even forbid their students even to listen to some other style, they feel they'll get polluted. That is in the same Carnatic music system. Exactly like that we have in Hindustani tradition also, they have Gharanas. So the Pune, Patiala Gharana, Kirana Gharana, there are so many Gharanas. Again, many of them are mutually exclusive. Now, at the end of the 20th century, some efforts are being made to bridge the gap and have a dialogue and conversation, as it were. Many times it will start as a friendly duet, but it will deteriorate into an unfriendly duel by the end, where you find Hindustani and Carnatic musicians sharing the stage and they'll be smiling at each other with their eye, with their mouth, but with their eyes they'll be like, oh, just done. One person will sustain a long note or sing a very fast phrase, and the other person is just trying to sing something longer and faster. where what is beautiful, what is necessary, what is aesthetic just goes to the dogs completely. So now in this time, when there is so much division still between different gharanas, different systems of Carnatic music, we had great, great, great people like Dikshitar, who traveled all around India. He went to Varanasi and he imbibed so much of Hindustani music. He imbibed so much of Western music, Muthuswami Dikshitar. And he even made more than 30 what they called note to swarams. Actually, note means swaram. But which are copies of existing European Western airs, and he put Sanskrit lyrics to them. Maharaja was not so fortunate because he was a ruling king. He didn't have the freedom to travel all around the country. But again, being Maharaja, he had the money and the power to bring the rest of the country to Trivandrum, as we saw earlier. So he was so open to other cultures, other languages, other systems of music, that he taught himself Carnatic music, which was essentially not a Keralaite thing, and educated himself in languages like Urdu, Brajbhasha, Hindi, Parsi, so Farsi from Persian, and composed authentic Hindustani compositions, not only Carnatic compositions based on Hindustani ragas, but pure Hindustani compositions also. To the best of my knowledge, I don't know anyone else who has excelled and made his mark so much in Talavarnams, Padavarnams, Jatiswaram, sets of Kirtanam like Navavidha Bhakti compositions, Navaratri Kirtanams, and in different forms of Hindustani compositions like Drupad, Khayal, Thumri, Tapa, Bhajan, Hori, all those compositions. And all this while ruling a country which was getting crushed by the dominating British rule and having lived only to be around 35 years. Even if he had lived 80 years, I would still say the wealth of his accomplishment was quite amazing. We have other people closer to our time like Bruce Lee, for the actor. People know him as a martial arts karate star in films, but he was a philosophy student and a philosopher himself, and he's written hundreds of pages of philosophy, which is so universal that if we are a dancer or a singer or a sportsman, what Bruce Lee has written, we can apply to our own chosen field. And he lived only to be around 32 years old. My current guru, Balamurli Krishna, is happily with us and very healthy, and he is 83 years old. But he composed and published a book with compositions in all the 72 Melakartha ragas when he was still just a teenager. So all these things make me believe that, earlier I used to wonder, how can one person have done so much within such a short time? And now I definitely believe it is possible. And of course, Sri Swathi Thirunal did not have distractions like the internet and Google and Facebook and Twitter and cable TV, or watching reality shows. So, he had more time to invest in a few fewer things and reach greater heights by not getting distributed. As for his, so this is just some background setting. As for his music, we have the few things which he showed us itself are very, very valuable. But that forms a very, very short, very small percentage of the wealth of compositions Maharaja has left us. In India, in the West, we have the tradition of, even if a child writes a four-line poem, the signature will be there, I wrote this. In India, it is opposite. It's exactly the opposite. There can be this huge, big Raja Gopuram of a temple, which can easily qualify to be one of the wonders of the world. But the architect doesn't leave his signature saying, I have reconstructed. They leave it and go. The same condition is there even now. Many of you would have heard the Nilakanta Sivan composition in Purva Kalyani, Ananda Nadamaduva Thillai. I have heard that from the time I was a child. But it was much later that I found out that my own Veena Guru, Professor K.S. Narayana Swami, he was the one who had set it to music in that raga. But he never told anybody. He said, that is the general attitude taken by most musicians. So with Maharaja's compositions also, there are, if we look at Tyagaraja, Dikshitar and all those people, Tyagaraja has a place which nobody else has. if you are from Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, or even if you are an NRI living in California and learning through Skype, even then, any normal student of Carnatic music can say that we are eating the salt of Tyagaraja. There is no two ways about that. I have four gurus, and all four of them, if I look at my current guru Balamurli Krishna, his guru Parupalli Ramakrishnaya Pantulu, his guru Susarala Dakshinamurthy, and his guru is Manamuchavali Vekta Subrahmanya, who is Tyagaraja's prime disciple and his relative also. Similarly, my other gurus in Veena and vocal music, I can trace all four gurus' lineage to Sri Tyagaraja. Tyagaraja, there is absolutely no need to try and see who is better. We can say, oh, Shama Shastri in one Bhairavi Swarajati, he has brought in the entire essence of Bhairavi. No other composer will come anywhere near Shama Shastri, where in one Swarajati he can do so much. Somebody else can say, oh, Tyagaraja never composed Varnams or Tilanas or Padams or Javalis. That is actually a stupid argument. It's like comparing, is this tea better or coffee better? I mean, each one is good in its own way. But Tyagaraja has, apart from the unquestionable musical merit, he has one advantage over probably every other composer, that is the Shishya Sampat, the wealth of disciples. We can write stuff in books, we can even make audio recordings and video recordings, which most people don't do. But the surefire way to keep a composition alive, and a song becomes a song only when it is sung, not when it is written in a book. So I generally encourage my students also to learn songs by heart and not keep it in the book, then it will remain only in the book. It has to enter our brain, our mind, our spirit, and our emotions. It will become ours, part of us, like our breath. Then only it becomes our song. Like that, compositions come alive only when they are sung. And Tyagaraja Swami has, probably more than any other composer, this huge big wealth of disciples. He would teach a set of songs to one disciple and another set of songs to another disciple, and they in turn would popularize these songs, because of which some paramparas, they say, because they haven't learned that song which he taught another disciple, they say, no, that is a spurious Tyagaraja Kriti, because I come from the authentic parampara and we don't sing this song. So I am absolutely no good at history, since though I am old, I am not that old that I was there during Tyagaraja's time. But Swathi Thirunal, the biggest tragedy is that, firstly, he lived for a very short time. Secondly, he was a ruling king. So he didn't have the freedom to devote his entire time, entire life to music, which I presume he would definitely have loved to do. And even the time he devoted to music was criticized heavily by the public at that time. They say this is a useless king by the end of his life, because he was so depressed and frustrated by the mantle of the British rule and the oppression, that he would spend more and more time in music. And they say, instead of ruling the king and looking after the administration all the time, he's involved in music. That is the situation. My heart really bleeds for him. But earlier what I was saying is that Sri Tyagaraja, if you sing Etavanara and Kalyani, and I sing Etavanara and Kalyani, some sangatis might be different, but basically it will be in Aditalam, it will be in Kalyani, and it would have more or less the same tune. That is because through the oral and oral tradition, the compositions have been preserved. There are another set of composers like Purandradasa, Annamacharya, Bhadrachala Ramadas, Sadashiva Brahmendra, where we know for sure that the tunes were lost, and they were tuned afresh by Vagyakaras or non-Vagyakaras in the 20th century. Maharaja Swathi Thirunal occupies an unfortunate grey area in between Tyagaraja on one side and Purandradasa, Bhadrachala Ramadas on the other side, because some compositions, as we saw in the slide show, the original tunes are there. Some other compositions, the original tunes were modified in the same raga. If you take Deva Deva Kalyani, for example, if you sing it, and I've heard Semamudi tell me that earlier it was in Misra Japotala. Deva Deva Kalyani, so Takita Takadimi Deva. Dev. So just make it a little more tight and more brisk and more concert worthy. Dev Dev Kalayami Te Charanambuja Sevanam in Ropakatalam. So that is slightly modified, there is not much difference. There are some songs where entirely new tunes have been given. Some by Mutaya Bhagwatar, some by Samangura Srinivasaya, some by later musicians like Professor T.V. Gopalakrishnan, my guru Dr. Balamurlikrishna, my Sri T.K. Govindarao. And now, and nobody has left a record, this was the original Maharaja's tune. This is Maharaja's tune and this raga, but I have changed it a little bit. But this is a totally fresh tune. So we have to use our own vidvat, our instincts and our feel for Maharaja to try and filter out what we presume would be Maharaja's original music. For this, some clues are there. Firstly, that he was very, very friendly with Hindustani music. Secondly, if we look at his romantic compositions, Sringara Padams, they are very, very sensual and equivalent to Jayadeva's Ashtapadis in the Sringaram content. Thirdly, he was very young when he died, and the spirit of a young man and an old man, of course there are some young men who are already old and there are some old men who are very young also. But generally speaking, that youthful spirit of his